roared and gammed it. This baby, it's fucking disgusting.
Yeah, yeah. It's fucking unethical.
It's raw, and it's like crying still.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, no.
Lore boys, Borbloys. Borb, you're really washed out now with that bright light. Here. Coming in hot with something called variety. Not Warhammer, not World of Warcraft, and not Catholics.
Yeah.
I am your host this week, Peter O'Donohue, and I am joined with, or by, whatever the correct grammar is.
Joined to Ethan Palmer.
Oh.
Nice to see you, Pete. And also being to you.
Yeah. And joined with, but recently separated from, James Miller.
Surgery was a success.
Yeah, I'm unclipped, unhinged, yeah. And able to enjoy things like private time, which was not possible before.
Showering without me. A big, big thing for Jamie was to shower without me. I don't know why, but it's done.
But I wanted to be with Ethan, and he was the middle piece, so it was kind of weird. We kind of had to do this folding thing and stick him out the door.
But it's doubly weird, because we unclipped Jamie from Peter, but then Peter was getting lonely in the shower, so now I've clipped to him. And now Jamie's outside the shower, so he's still not with me. It's unfortunate. We don't know how the math works out on this and how we can kind of figure out the ideal situation for all of us. But just so you guys know, we're still working on you here at the Lore Boys HQ.
Healthcare in Canada is free, so we can burn up as much tax money as we want. As we want, experimenting with this whole thing.
Every other week. We're just in the doctor's office. Yeah. Sew us together. Separate us. Sew us together.
Free healthcare for all our American listeners out there means that you can go to the doctor with any bullshit surgery claim and they legally have to give it to you.
You can arrest them.
Yeah, you can just tell them anything and they legally have to do that surgery on you. So it's pretty exciting to be in the Socialist Republic of Canada these days.
Sew me to this guy. I don't think that's safe, sir. Citizen's arrest!
Yeah.
For a week, get a new doctor in there.
Yeah.
If you want for a week, you can have hands for feet and feet for hands. Yeah. And you don't like it, you go back next week.
You go back, no problem. Yeah.
Yeah. You're basically just a build your own action figure when you have free healthcare.
Mr. Potato Head.
Yeah, exactly.
We are a nation of Mr. Potato Heads.
Tommy Douglas invented the Mr. Potato Head first, and then just like Canada should have free healthcare.
Mattel actually originally branded the Mr. Potato Head as Mr. Canada, but they got sued by the Canadian government, and they had to change it. So,
yeah. Also, yeah. Didn't sell well in America. So, Potato Head though, they love potatoes.
Exactly.
Free fries, all that shit. Anyway, that's a little bit of a factoid about us. But today we're going to be doing a request from Saucy of the God Hand made in our Discord. If you want to fold up virtual slips of paper and slide them into our virtual suggestion box, please go to theloreboys.com, find the Discord link, and join up. A lot of new people there just in the past week. It's always a pleasure to have you. Come in, make friends, and tell us what to do, basically.
Yeah, it's loreboys.com/about. I'll take it right there.
The link to the Discord.
After the last World of Warcraft episode, the heart tech in our Discord reached out to me and asked for the server, so I'm going to get yet another listener in. That'd be two in our guild, which is cool.
Nice. Now if only we could start dealing drugs and get them addicted to something more profitable.
Yeah, profitable for us.
Yeah, exactly.
I have no doubt that Blizzard makes more than any drug kingpin out there by abusing people's loneliness.
If I get 200 bug pieces months down the line, it's worth it.
Yeah, exactly. But you don't understand. They give me 3 or 4 an hour. I just got to keep hitting them, you know? No problem.
Exactly.
What's 40,000?
We're not talking about 42. Yeah, Jesus.
Jesus Christ. Yeah. So today, we're going to be covering Battle Angel Alita, which originally was a manga, which is French for my dude or my guy.
Yeah.
And as we know, the French are very friendly and love backwards books.
Most people don't know that Japanese manga actually originated in French Canada. So,
whoa.
That's a nice little bit of a lore tidbit for you.
So from what I understand, manga in Japan is often released in like large monthly compilation novels. So you may have heard the term Shonen Jump if you or anyone you know reads manga or watches anime. So like stuff like One Piece, Naruto, or like Hunter x Hunter are part of Shonen Jump, which is always like about a young hero boy.
Yep. Okay. That adds
up. I think that's correct. That's lore boy's canon. Alita ran from 1990 to 1995 in Business Jump. Business Jump ran from 1985 to 2011 and was marketed as the first salaryman Jump magazine. A salaryman being a slang for a Japanese white collar worker. So,
okay,
they marketed this as like, no, you're not a child. You can here's your book of cartoons drawn by perverts. you can read on the train. It's Business Jump.
So,
there's 15 pages of him just like with his 401k, just getting that all settled.
Oh yeah,
setting up health insurance. Like, yeah, it's really riveting.
So Shonen does specifically refer to aimed at like young male audience, I think.
Yeah, so
similar
that's what
to the heroes, yeah. I guess in the. Because One Piece is the lanky guy. Naruto, it's Naruto. Hunter x Hunter, I don't think I've ever seen. I have an image in my head, but I'm sure it's from My Hero Academia that I'm actually thinking of.
Hunter is... a friend of mine was watching it and explained it to me. I've seen the title card on Netflix. It's like a kid with black hair wearing green. But I actually do know about My Hero, and he does look a lot like that. Like the dark hair, the green suit. Like it's very, very similar.
Okay. I guess it's maybe good to preface this for any beautiful weeaboos who are just finding the show for the first time, because we're talking about something that they care about and they're passionate about, that none of us really subscribe to anime or manga in any kind of real ways. The closest I can claim is I've watched all of Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood and One Punch Man. Well, so far what's been released. Never really read manga. I started reading Naruto, but I couldn't get past like the neighboring town's attack with the sand monster. I didn't get that far into it. And I mean, that far into Naruto is how much time are you willing to commit? I was not willing to commit that much time, but I spent like a couple weeks one summer just like reading it for like 8 hours a day while I was working the hunters in the horse world, not the hunter cross hunters.
I don't dislike it by any means, but it just hasn't kind of like fallen into my lap in the right way, I guess. Yeah. I don't watch a lot of TV or read a lot these days anyways, so for me to get into that genre would be just like an extra barrier that I'm not really like. I'd be happy to do it. It just hasn't happened kind of thing.
Jamie only watches Alex Jones's InfoWars, so.
Yeah. And I'm an Amaranth tier 3 sub too. I'm pretty sure she's going to talk to me soon, so
it's all going to be worth it. That loan was definitely worth it.
Yeah.
Definitely.
I've also watched season 1 of One Punch Man cuz it's on Canadian Netflix. I have not watched season 2
cuz it's not on Canadian Netflix.
Exactly. And then I've watched Stardust Crusaders, so JoJo part 3. I've seen that.
Yeah, I read the first ever edition of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure.
Yeah, my girlfriend tried to get me to watch Beastars, and I don't like it. That's the last thing I attempted.
Is that on TLC where they're trying to sell you honey and like name the right price and everything?
Oh yeah,
I have honey auctions. They open up old lockers full of bees with like a crowd of people just gathered outside.
Like they stung the shit out of me, but like I'm not really that stung. So the best I'll offer you is $25.
Yeah.
Come on, man. Those bees stung you a million times. It's got to be worth at least $100. It's all right, fine. I'll do $30 for all these bees.
Yeah, but the queen didn't read my dono on stream, so you know.
Oh yeah.
yes. Watch your profanity.
Watch your profanity. So I'll just say, anybody new listening, we don't know that much about anime, but we're gonna do our good golly gosh darned to talk about it.
We're gonna stumble through this for the fans because they're the reason we still do this, because we love you. But sorry in advance, I guess, is that long-winded explanation.
although that could apply to, I don't know why I'm prefacing this for the anime one, because it's probably more of an insult that the topics that we do know about, we still stumble through and get wrong a lot of the time. Like I've recently been doing a lot of Warhammer 40K, and this is something that I have thought since I was in high school, that the God Emperor of Mankind was born in the 8th century, or in the 8th millennium in Turkey. He was born in the 8th millennium BC. He was born, I was off by 16,000 years.
Way older.
Like, way older. It's like, it changes everything. Somebody mentioned it on the Discord the other day. They're like, hey, just by the way, you're off by 16,000 years. I was like, oh, okay.
Fuck.
And that's always been a piece of lore that I've had in the back of my head. Like, I've never really researched the God Emperor all that much for the show, but it's just always been back there. And I've mentioned it, I think, on every one of our 40K episodes. Yeah. And I've been getting it wrong every time.
It turns out Dr. Wily doesn't even watch Mega Man shower.
Well,
crazy. What?
That's
bullshit.
That doesn't sound right.
Dr. Wily.
Dr. Wily. Anyway, okay. speaking of strange Japanese art, the creator of Alita is named Yukito Kushiro, and he found inspiration in older mecha series like Gundam when he started writing Alita. Let's battle Angel Alita in Japan. And just going forward as well, I will be using the English names for everything. The Alita in Japan is called Gali or Gari, for example.
Okay. That's like way different.
I've taken the English names just for my own, because it's just easier, basically.
Sure. Yeah. Because we don't want to butcher the Japanese names, whereas we have no problem butchering the American names.
Exactly. I butcher American stuff all the time. All right. So what's it about? What is Battle Angel Alita? The titular character, Alita, is a cyborg found in and around Kansas City, Missouri, for whatever reason, in what is now called the scrapyard on Earth in the 26th century by a cyber physician named Daisuke Ito. This being a human doctor who works on cyborgs and not a cybernetic doctor, because that would be ridiculous.
Oh, okay, not a cyborg doctor, a cyborg doctor, if you will.
Yeah.
Not Dr. Cyborg, but a cyborg doctor.
He's not a cyborg doctor.
Yeah.
Is he a robot with a hammer in his hand hitting a human's knee, or a human with a hammer in his hand hitting a robot's knee?
The latter.
The second one.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, the latter.
All right.
Yeah. And he also has a Go-Go Gadget ladder extension that he can pull out of his pants. Oh, no, wait. No, sorry. I'm thinking of Dr. Cyborg again. My bad.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, there we go. Yeah, that's wrong. he's generally referred to as Dr. Ito in the manga and the anime anyway, so it's very easy. So he's one of the names that I didn't have to change just to pronounce properly. The scrapyard is a terrestrial shanty town that is formed around the trash dumped out of the bottom of the floating city of Zalem.
Okay.
Oh. So there's a city floating above Kansas City, Missouri now, and it just dumps its like cybernetic future waste onto the ground, and there's a shanty town that is built up around.
And Kansas City looks like, sorry, go ahead.
Go ahead. It's just like Final Fantasy VII, the slums that you start off in.
Midgard.
You're like underneath, Midgard. You're underneath Sector 7, and you're basically living off the trash of the people who live up there.
And I was going to say Kansas City modern day is completely indistinguishable from the slums of Midgard. So.
Yeah, well, it's when Kansas City is directly below St. Louis, Missouri, and they live off the trash dumped down from St. Louis.
Yeah. and I guess it all flows to Cleveland. I don't know how the U.S. works.
It's in Ohio. Fuck it.
Yeah, sure. Could be.
So Zalem is suspended by an orbital ring off the ground. So basically, well, you know the rings of Saturn, right?
Yes, I'm familiar.
I've never been, but I've heard of them.
I'm familiar.
But you've seen the postcards, right?
Yeah.
So the orbital ring is basically just a giant mechanical ring built around the planet Earth. And Zalem hangs down from that to stay off of the filthy, filthy peasant Earth, basically.
Okay.
So it's suspended up in the air. It is also
Zalem, Massachusetts. Is that where the witch trials were held? Or
yeah. Well, so there's Zalem, Oregon, and Zalem, Massachusetts.
Oh,
there's two different.
Okay.
Ones
that's it. I get it mixed up all the time. Yeah.
The Puritans were in Massachusetts.
Okay.
So it's like a trickle-down economy, right? All the rich people are higher up, and then all the peasants are on the earth kind of thing, or what?
Their trash trickles down.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I do love that the perfect analogy for the trickle-down economy is that rich people throw their trash on poor people.
Yeah. it's exactly like that, but instead of Wall Street, it's an orbital ring suspended over Missouri. it also has these huge cables that tether it to the planet. Otherwise, it would just be total chaos with the fucking whatever suburbia just flying around the entire planet all the time, just crashing through shit, right? And in case the lay people get too many opinions or stupid ideas in their head and think I could climb that big cable, They also have these gigantic proletariat shredding saw blades that can spin and shoot down the cables to clean them off, basically. Like, it's like a big automatic barnacle scraper for like the outside of a ship.
That seems like the least efficient way to clear your cables. Just run a current through them.
I was gonna say, yeah.
My God.
No, but then they'd all hook up their trailers and everything to it, and then to get free power. Can't
That's smart, yeah. Or maybe just the rich people throw out a lot of rubber, and they're like, no, they got too much rubber down there. We got no problem.
Bouncy shoes. Yeah.
I meant because rubber insulates against electric current. Not. I was not positing that they would moon bounce their way up to the upper ring.
I was kind of expanding on your rubber moon boot scrapyard invention, where if you could just jump, you could minimize contact with the electrified cables regardless.
Oh, I see.
And still be safe.
And be inactive. Dude,
if you ever forget like a can opener or something, that's perfect. You just go find the nearest tether, you hold your can out, you move your head away.
Yeah.
And when your dominant hand holding the can of tuna is entirely atomized by the spinning blades, you can just be like, oh, good. And then you can rummage through the trash to find your empty can somewhere.
So does it shoot the blades down and then the blades are like left on the ground?
No, they can run up and down. Okay. So it's not like saw blades. It's not like the saw blades you would see in like a wall in a 2D game where they just kind of buzz up and down. It's like a rotating spiraling ring that it looks like a garbage disposal, but the garbage is poor people, and it just rotates all the way down like a corkscrew and can rotate all the way up.
There you go.
So it's like it goes up and down like if you put a ring on your finger, basically.
Okay.
Yeah. So anyway, that's Zalem and how they stay safe, basically. So like all well-written characters, Alita has amnesia. However, her story is revealed over the course of the manga. The series ran as Battle Angel Alita, Battle Angel Alita Last Order, and then finally Battle Angel Alita Mars Chronicles. Mars Chronicles revealed a lot, so did Last Order. So much of the focus today is on Alita and her universe that she's a part of, and not so much like character bios or anything like that. I didn't want to spoil anything from the manga or the films, basically. So this is all just set up for, frankly, movies we'll probably never see because I don't know how much money that movie even made. In Last Order, she has revealed that humanity is as humanity does. And say it with me, colonize the solar system.
Oh, yeah.
Colonize the solar system.
Perfect. We can cut that down.
Colonize the solar system.
They also invented a new calendar. For some fucking reason.
Or was it, sorry, colonize the solar system or solarize the colon system? Did I mess that up?
Ooh, I need to check my notes. Yeah. I don't know.
we'll figure it out in post.
We'll have to check that in post.
Yeah.
That sounds like some fucking late night TV advertisement for some sort of medical quackery.
Yeah, just yeah.
Like, colonize. Exactly.
solarize your colon.
Too much spicy colon system.
What's it? Wasn't
feel
that
like
a...
there's razor blades flying up and down your tether?
Yeah.
You can solarize your colon system.
Wasn't that a thing recently though that people were like sunbathing their buttholes because they said it would like cure coronavirus or something like that?
Frankly, if you told me blank 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 because people thought it would cure coronavirus, I would believe you.
Okay, fair. Especially
there was a doctor recently who was just like, yeah, no, this totally works. We should use it more. And then her other opinion is that having sex with demons in your dreams causes impotence.
Yeah.
So it's like, we should check in on the rest of her credentials.
No, I think they're right. You got to sun your butt and you got to burn your vagina candle. And all of it is good for you.
All of it is good for you.
Yeah.
Beneth Baltro, Bisbell's bike by Babina. So generally speaking in fiction or in ever, like if you look at Pol Pot, if you change the calendar, it's for a big dick reason, right? Like it's for a really important reason.
Uh-huh.
Like
when some... the Lore Boys was inducted and we rearranged the calendar, so now it's year 3.
Didn't we reset the calendar again when we got on Spotify? So we're still in year one.
Still year one. It's year 1-3. It's the third year one.
When did we start? What year was it? 2017?
20, yeah.
Sure.
Okay. Nice even number.
No,
If we, I mean, it's an odd number, but sure.
I don't know. Math is hard. If we started in 2017, wouldn't we be on our fourth year? Anyway, we don't have to talk about this on the podcast.
we're in the second era, year one, of the Spotify empire of the lore boys.
Okay.
All right.
That's how we do it.
And when's Alila?
Galila. So I want you guys to guess. In a cyberpunk dystopia where rich people float above the ground, what kind of event do you think could have caused humanity to change the calendar? Ethan.
When Mr. Pepsi was finally elected president.
Okay. Jamie?
Whenever the tethers to the earth stopped being attached to the ring, and then all the people were spinning, but the ring was staying still. So then all the tethers were just lashing all of the cities of the people.
Okay, so something apocalyptic is close. Ethan, do you have a second Pepsi-related guess or some other soda?
I had another more serious guess, but now you said something apocalypse-related, so I know it's not right. I was going to say when we finally colonized Mars.
Okay.
Or the moon, I guess. Colonized anything.
You're both wrong, because they changed this calendar for literally no good reason. Year one has been started in 1957 and is now known as ES, or Era Sputnik.
No, but 1957 was the first year of the Pepsi Challenge.
Oh, so.
Is that true?
Yeah, I know a lot about the Pepsi Challenge. I know the year that it started somehow, but yes, totally.
It's EP now, so it's Era Pepsi. Year one now is 1957, when the first artificial satellite was sent into orbit around Earth. Yeah. Sputnik 1 was launched October 1957, and Sputnik 2 was launched in November. Now, I did, because they do have a little monument to Laika, the space dog, was in the Sputnik 2.
Yeah.
I want to do some quick Soviet lore. So Sputnik 2 contained a three-year-old street dog named Laika who died during the mission. And just to hammer and sickle home how worthless the truth in the USSR was, the dog's actual cause of death was not made public until 2002.
Wow. That's cool. I didn't. One of the streamers like to watch Stay Safe TV named his dog Laika, and now I think it's probably for that reason.
She's the only famous dog named Laika. It's like Russian for friend or friendship or something like that.
The first dog in space.
Yeah. So the Soviets apparently couldn't admit how their space dog was dead the whole time, so they told the rest of the world she had died of lack of oxygen after 6 days, and even claimed they had a euthanization system to humanely kill her in space before oxygen ran out and she suffered.
Giant saw blades inside the shuttle.
Exactly, yes. What we now know, what's been declassified, is that she overheated and died within hours due to cheap and shitty Soviet engineering. She was dead the entire time she was up there.
So technically not the first dog in space.
I mean, I guess she wouldn't have even made it, but I just think it was ridiculous. It's just like they couldn't tell the truth about their space dog, even just like okay, well, fine, fuck it.
Have you guys seen when they bring the cats up to zero gravity? I saw that on the internet the other day.
Oh, they get so confused.
They do it in the vomit comet or whatever it is.
Thing where they fly up and then like
the plane
angle downwards, so it's like it simulates zero G or whatever.
It is. They just hate it so much. It's very cute.
Yeah.
But they have a monument to Laika in Alita because she was the first mammal to be launched into orbit.
Mm-hmm. She was.
So the solar system is largely controlled by three groups. We have the Jupiter System Union, people who have colonized the habitable moons of Jupiter. Excuse me.
Okay.
And this web of small colonies. Io, Europa, Ganymede. Other ones. This web of small colonies has a powerful AI network called Zeus, which controls basically everything their actual colony does, which I guess they named Zeus to laugh in the face of the Romans, who changed the name of Zeus to Jupiter when they were doing their fan canon of like King of the Gods, basically. Yeah. So as Jupiter very likely does not have solid ground to walk on or build on, not to mention the gravity that would crush anything that tried to land, the habitable space in the Union is on a huge shell around the planet that isn't complete, so it looks more like a round cage because they didn't have enough material. They used the less cool moons as material to build their giant kind of webbed shell around the planet.
Their network.
It's made out of cheese. Wow.
Who would have knew, yeah. Huh? Soft cheese, though. If it was made of hard cheese, there's no problem. But because True. It's made of soft cheese.
Yeah. I mean, that'll probably lead to the more of the conflicts later on is the lack of hard cheese in the solar system. So the Jovians don't particularly like... This is people who live on Jupiter, or around it, I guess. Mm-hmm. The Jovians don't like individuals or questions very much, and they have adopted a uniform look as machine-like cyborgs. So they're still technically a human brain, but the most common way that the Jovians look, they just look like two gray stacked boxes, basically.
Okay.
They have a big smile, right? Because they're jovial as well.
I think they can customize it, probably.
Okay, cool.
Whatever you put on the outside of the shell as a personality is definitely is optional cybernetic surgery. Okay. But yeah, it's two stacked boxes on wheels with one big dumb robot eye in the middle that has like a manipulatable eyelid shell to kind of express basic emotions, and then just a stump with two little mechanical tentacles hanging off the front of it can actually... manipulate things.
Can I just say, I googled this to see what they actually look like, and the first hit was a sexy one. So that should tell. He's in like white cotton underwear. I just threw him in the threw him in our chat here for you guys.
That's manga for you.
Yeah, look at that.
Oh yeah, dude. Actually, this is official art. I was about to talk about this guy in a second. Oh,
okay, cool. Is a sexy one. Good.
One Jovian in particular has a humanoid-shaped body below the regular Jovian box, and his name is Chernov 727.
Okay. Jovian also refers to anything to do with Jupiter, including a Jovian emperor, Flavius Ionivus Augustus, for whom it was presumably named after.
I'd be pretty jovial if I had abs, pecs, and pack in a bulge like old Chernov 727 here, so he's probably pretty jovial as well. So
I love how boxy his gooch is. Like, it's just a straight line, you know?
Yeah. I mean, they've got to be consistent. Remember, it's like, if all of us are going to be boxes, but you want to be sexy, you better have an angular grundle, like, no matter what, right? next, we have La République Venus.
Okay.
Donc, Venus has a very high temperature. It is about 800 degrees Celsius on the surface.
Okay.
So it has the highest temperature. I can't do that forever. It dries up my tongue. Since it has the highest temperature of the solar system after the sun, obviously.
How do French people do it? If it dries out your tongue, huh?
They
can do it all the time. Yeah.
They just drink wine.
True. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So it dries out real quick, just like your mouth, because it's so hot.
Yeah, they drink a lot of wine and kiss all the time with tongue to, I guess.
Oh, that's where the tongue kiss comes from. Okay, yeah. That makes sense, though.
That would make sense, yeah. Because like when my mouth is super dry, and my girlfriend's here, I'm just like, Dara, give me a kiss. I gotta do the podcast, moisten me up, and she'll just like, you know, spray into my mouth if she's indisposed, or give me a nice kiss.
Yeah.
Spray into, that's so gross.
Just like a little misting bottle, if you were taking care of plants.
You know, sometimes you curl your tongue a bit, and it like does the little squirt of spit across the room.
Yeah.
Just that. Dara. That's what Dara does into Peter's mouth.
Yeah, all the time. So to colonize Venus, humanity set up a huge solar shield, basically, to just kind of cool down a section of the planet directly below it. They were just like, okay, cool. We don't have a lot to work with here, guys. So we can set up maybe some freezing cold farmland if we put a big shell or like a big wall in the way of the sun. And everybody was like, yeah, I guess that's just what we're going to do. So now, after setting up this solar shield, floating colonies can exist close to the planet. They're about 8 kilometers up, or 5 miles for any low-born non-metric system using people.
Sure.
And the first colony on Venus was established in ES, or I guess EP, so Era Pepsi 242. or with our Gregorian calendar, 2199 AD.
Okay.
Yeah, still in the future, but...
pretty far.
Unsponsored. In our unsponsored calendar, it's 2199.
Yeah, exactly. Our non-corporate.
Yeah.
I thought you said you said this was in business jump, not
that's true.
Unsponsored jump.
That's why. The Republic was founded 8 years after that.
Okay. After the shield was put up on Venus.
2207, yeah. They needed to let things cool down a bit, both literally and figuratively, because the shield, I guess, was stolen. They're like, we got some hot property. Let's hide it in the sun. And they're like, okay.
They'll never think to look for it there.
Got a bunch of cops on Earth staring at the sun in binoculars. It's like, we'll never find it.
It's too bright.
take that, Flatfoot. And he's just like running off to Venus. Right. So in that'd be 2207, the Republic was founded. They've also turned the surface of Mercury into something called gray goo, which I think is some kind of sci-fi trope. I don't know if either one of you can expand on that, because there's a video game just called gray goo.
Oh, yeah.
This is a good Jamie pull up the clip moment here, because I am curious about this.
Gray sounds like... Oh, go for it.
I think it's more fun if you pause it what you think it sounds like before I just read the definition online.
All right.
I like that.
Well, I think it sounds like gray goo sounds like the something to make life out of. Like it's the building blocks for life. You need like a gray goo, you add a little spice and something nice, and then you're able to make a mouse or something.
It's
like
Chemical
that.
X was for the Powerpuff Girls.
Pretty close. It's actually, if you listen to our Surge episode, it's gluten. It's the idea that self-replicating nanotechnology gets out of control and just devours all life. So it's just this like metallic fluid that just like consumes everything while it's just like going haywire and trying to self-replicate. It's an extinction event in theory.
Yeah. It seems as though they did that to Mercury on purpose. I don't know if they just need it or whatever, but yeah, the surface of Mercury is gray goo.
It would also work. If you're short on self-replicating all-consuming nanotechnology, then maybe you just use the surface of Mercury.
It would make sense because the people of Venus or the Venusians are very, very fond of genetic engineering, and they use nanomachines as well. Yes.
And they all have big penises, right? Because that's how you go to Venus.
I'll get into a description of what they look like. It would have to be hidden somewhere.
Okay.
if I'll ask you guys whether you want to be from Jupiter or from Venus, to be stupid or penis. And frankly, I don't think the answer is going to be penis.
Yeah,
for the record.
I just realized we're still talking about an anime, and there's this girl. What's her name again? The main character?
Alita.
So we're just building the world right now, and then we'll see how Alita fits into it.
This would be Alita. Ooh.
Oh.
I'll yet to be the Alita on...
Peter streamed at twitch.tv/thelorevoice today, and you can tell he's like on now. His jokes are coming quick.
Thank you. So they attempted to turn themselves into perfect human beings. You may have heard this from, again, I guess we'll talk about him again. You may have heard what peak physical male fitness looks like from Alex Jones. I don't know. I can't believe I'm saying this. He seems to be closer to right than the Venusians certainly are, because the Venusians, their peak physical form appears to be like Easter Island heads.
I can't disagree with that.
They're just big, fat heads with vestigial arms and legs, and they roll around on tall three-wheeled tricycles. And the slang term for this peak human form is just called Humpty Dumpty.
Because I know there's probably a name for it, but the picture of like the monkeys following the monkey, following the monkey, following the half man, half monkey, following the man.
Yes, I did see that picture. Yeah.
You saw the graphic, and it goes to the man, Jamie, and then it goes to a shorter, much fatter man, and then it goes to a floating, very fat man with a massive head and a tiny little skinny leg.
You
know what? I think that is pretty close to peak physical form.
I take that over two boxes any day.
Yeah. Really? I would be too. I would, if I was just a brain inside two angry boxes, I would take that.
Dude, I mean, the square gooch really does sell it, but
I think that.
Oh yeah, no, that's true.
I like that. I like that picture because it's self confirming for me. I'm the one after man towards the little head at this point.
You're already now it's like sunk cost fallacy. You're like, well, I'm already on my way there, so I'm not gonna stop now.
Exactly. Humpty-dumpty, apparently. So obviously it's called the Republic Venus with accents on the E's, thankfully.
Republic.
They share much culture with the French of Earth, using many of like the French language for names, and both their love of wine and eating babies.
I mean, sorry, Frenchmen, we've talked about this before. Guillotines don't work in space.
No, exactly. So you better start eating babies if you want to change, apparently.
You know what? Cigarettes don't either. So I don't know what they're going to do up there.
Oh, yeah. No oxygen. Can't smoke. At least you had one of, like, a really long cigarette stem that just went back into the atmosphere.
Back into the atmosphere.
I finally saw the picture you're talking about, and they're way more grotesque than I expected.
Yeah. You're like, I'm down for it. And then you see them, you're like, oh, I'm not down for it.
No, yeah. Like, the last
thing
one
doesn't sound so bad, eh?
His jowls are so huge, like, and the big, ugh.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. His head is very big.
Yeah,
his head and his jawline. I mean, that's quite the jawline, I guess you could say.
Yeah, the skeleton must look so stupid.
So
do you think their joints are even attached? Because, you know, whales have rear legs and hip bones, but they kind of just float around inside the body.
Do they?
So do you think their arms are just not even attached to like their shoulders or their spines at
could
all?
Be.
Oh, we got our animal fact in. We can punch out, guys.
I got another one for you here. Elephant skulls look super human-like. If they
look like a cyclops.
If they've lost the tusk, they look like a cyclops, and so that's why a lot of people think that cyclops myths come from like India and places like that, because they just found elephant skulls and were like, this is a giant man who clearly only had one eye. And I'm looking at this. I'm looking at this fat levitating man, and I'm thinking, he probably has an elephant skull for a skull, right?
Yeah. Wow.
This fat levitating man.
Where can you get an elephant skull?
Legally or illegally?
Are you allowed to have one if it was like a natural death?
I would assume so. Yeah. But you can get ivory. You can get like ethically sourced ivory, too.
Yeah.
The elephant gets a massage while they cut off part of its face.
I feel like if it broke off in a fight with another bull elephant, you could probably just grab that and turn it into a decoration.
Or if it just died. Yeah.
I'm a conspiracy theorist. Oh, I think that we're manufacturing all of the conflict between bull elephants just to get their ivory.
Just to get their ivory.
Yeah. Steve said you look dumb and he's gonna fuck your wife.
We're injecting them. We're injecting elephants with bull shark testosterone to make them more angry, so they fight
more aggressive.
Yeah.
So with the Venusians, you may have this whole baby eating thing was not just a cheeky stab at our Earth's French. They actually have a genetically modified non-sentient human species called Homo esculentus, which is old Italian for edible man, and this is a vat grown or something human specifically for eating. They explain this as saying, since they're so close to us genetically, they're the ultimate part of a balanced breakfast.
I don't think that's how Maslow's food pyramid works.
No, that makes sense, dude. Like, if you need to run a body, then what better to like replenish your body than more body?
Yeah, like I have one here. I don't know why I keep having so many food pyramid examples recently, but like thankfully I have one here, and all of it is just GMO baby meat. So don't fucking worry about it.
I have a question.
Yeah.
What are you feeding the people? What goes into their diet to make them the perfect diet for you?
Chicken and the egg, dude. Chicken.
How is that a chicken and an egg? Feed them chicken and eggs. Just eat the chicken and the eggs. Oh my god.
No, Jamie's right. Chicken and the egg, dude. What do you get? The Venusian or the Homo esculentus?
Don't Ben Shapiro me by just saying chicken and egg when we're having a discussion.
Dude, if people need to eat people to be people, then where did the first person come from? Who was the first meal? Who was the first person?
I'm saying people don't.
Vegetarian. You wouldn't get it.
That is true. I'm a vegetarian. I have to take multivitamins, which, as far as I know, do come from human flesh. So
that's the start of it. Maybe you'll be the first one when your first shipment of baby meat shows up. You'll be the first one to try it because you're like, oh, Centrum is making something much chewier now. Apparently,
But it's chewable sourced baby meat. The babies fight, and if one passes away.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's it. Yeah. We do inject them with bull shark testosterone, but, you know, that's whatever.
Yes. They apparently don't even need to worry about this, because these are a non-sentient species specifically grown. So I don't know if it's just, like, neck down baby meat, with no brain, grown into
We call the episode "Neck Down, Baby Meat." Yes.
I'm not opposed to that.
So I think this is ethically worse, the fact that they're like unconsenting, you know?
I mean, I'm not sure where they got the genetic seed from, to use like from a Warhammer term.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know where they got the actual like basis to grow the first edible baby.
Yeah, like
Wait, I feel like we've gotten far away from
this is all Alita Battle Angel now. I mean, this is
we're still talking about eating babies, which is totally relevant, Jamie. Don't you worry.
This is all canon, man. This is all canon. Okay? Yeah. We gotta get to the bottom of
this. To be clear, it's the Venusians that were eating, or it's a different one?
Venusians. Okay. The guys who made themselves into the fat, levitating Easter Island egghead guys.
Yeah. There's like some story where apparently they saw some babies at a restaurant and thought they looked tasty, so they decided to grow baby meat. After that,
jonesing for a California burger, man.
Oh, it's a California cheeseburger. Yeah. That might be good art. I could take that scene and put just a Venusian hippie woman in there. Other than baby meat, they also invented something called Methuselization, which is the installation of nanomachines to make themselves immortal. This is named after the oldest man in the Bible, Methuselah.
Which you won us around a bar trivia once by knowing that. And I guess that also that's also where the gray goo on Mercury comes from.
That would be my best guess. Again, like doing a lot of the fan research for this is tricky, and I'm not an anime or manga person. So for me, it was like waking up from a coma and then somebody just started talking at me. I was like, oh my God,
somebody's
what is
this? They eat babies now, but it's okay because they're too dumb to know any better. And very big.
Yeah. So politics being politics. So those are two of the factions there. You have the Jupiter and then you have Venus.
And maybe you're about to jump into this. Is the third one the Earth people? Or
yes.
Okay, yeah. I wasn't sure if they fit into one of those.
Yeah, they're going to come up next because I'm trying to do this kind of in order of how they occurred, just to lead up to the manga. Okay. Politics being politics, a dispute came up between Jupiter and Venus regarding the ownership of an Enceladus, which was one of the moons of Saturn. Okay.
Okay.
Venus wanted it as part of a terraforming operation, and Jupiter wanted it for more general resources. Excuse me. I think it's because they couldn't complete their Jovian shell because they ran out of garbage moons to recycle into construction material.
It seems like a super inefficient way to do things. Just build a space station in space, guys.
Yeah, exactly.
The cheese is just going to keep falling down, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like if you put the cheese all in one place and didn't use some of the cheese to build on top of, and they were just like, get out of here, or beep, or wheeled up, because of course they're boxes with tentacles, and just be like, beep, boop, get the fuck out of here, with a little squinty camera eye.
Yeah. A little known fact about Enceladus, the moon of Saturn, is that it's entirely made of cheesecloth. So,
So they could push other moons through it to dry it out.
Yeah, exactly. It's also an effective way of drying out your nanomachines.
Oh,
yeah.
Well, that makes sense.
Exactly. Cheesecloth. That's why they both wanted them. Yeah.
Oh, you got to put your gray goo through the cheesecloth.
Exactly. Or
I learned that would explain the beeswax that we were talking about earlier. Yeah. A lot of that was soaked in beeswax in the medieval times to prevent spoilage.
Yeah. Rorden Gamzee taught me that one.
Rorden Gamzee? This baby, it's fucking disgusting.
Yeah. It's fucking unethical.
It's raw and it's like crying still.
Yeah.
Oh, no. Big dumb Venusian waiter on his wheels just like turns around and just like rolls back into the kitchen, just like scrapes it off the plate into the trash, just like, Gordon didn't like it. He's like, oh, what the fuck is wrong with it? He's like, I said it was too raw. And then it cuts to like the chef camera where it's the Venusian guy. He's just like, what, he want a fresh baby? I gave him a fresh baby. I don't know what the fuck is going on. Nobody else has ever complained.
Look, in my restaurant we've done fresh babies for as long as I can remember. The customers are always happy. Okay.
So the argument over Enceladus led to the terraforming wars, and needing to pick a side, Earth sided with Venus. Possibly due to being closer, or possibly due to France being on Earth and not wanting to offend any of the sweaty baby eaters or their hairy women.
Okay.
I know why Ethan would side with Venus.
Why is that?
For penis.
Yeah, more penis. Oh, right. Yeah. I forgot about that. I was going to say, because I think Jupiter's idea of their stupid metal grate over the surface of Jupiter is really dumb. That's why. I mean, I don't know how I feel about Venus's food choices when we know how to make food. Like, that's not a mystery, yeah. You know? I don't know why, if you're going meat, it's got to be people meat, but I guess it's because it's the key to a balanced diet. Those old Lucky Charm commercials when they'd say part of a balanced breakfast, and it'd always be a bowl of Lucky Charms, a slice of orange, and then a bowl of human meat?
Oh, yeah, that does make a lot of sense.
Yeah, yeah.
Part of a balanced breakfast, one in, one out.
Jesus. Yeah. Oh, God.
I don't think, probably in the actual lore of this, there's not so heavy reliance on eating babies.
And maybe I'm jumping to a topic that you don't know, but maybe if somebody at home knows, they could let us know. Is it like, do other people, do the Earth people, like, look down on them for this practice, this growing human meat to eat it?
Not to my knowledge, because the people of Earth generally live in poverty, and the rich people live on the floating city.
Okay. And so the poor people don't know about it, they're rich people, so they don't care about human lives?
I will shortly get into just how valuable human life is in a couple of moments, and then we can make a decision on what exactly is going on here. So the terraforming wars are some of the most significant events in the Alita timeline. The results of these wars are the baseline for what normal now is in when the manga opens. The most significant operation during this conflict was the mission called Operation Malwerf. Now we're going to start talking about Mars. Mars isn't really one of the three superpowers because they kind of exist as a neutral territory. They're very Swiss.
Okay.
But they do have, like, cyborgs and cyborg training facilities and shit like that on Mars.
Do you mean they're made out of Swiss cheese? Because I know a lot of cheeses around.
Yeah.
Only non-cheese related part. The cyborgs are made of, like, self-healing metal and shit like that.
Oh, okay.
Cool.
Got it.
Cool.
Yeah. Right. The one part of Battle Angel Alita that isn't based around cheese, it would probably be the Martians.
The Martians, yeah.
Cool.
Ethically sourced self-healing robots, right?
Yeah, that too. So during Operation Malwerf, Jupiter hired a group of cyborg mercenaries called the Grunthal, and sent them on a mission to destroy Earth's supercomputer, which is called Melchizedek, since it was running much of their military operations on Zalem and in floating space colonies and other stuff that was kind of around the solar system.
Okay, hold on. During the terraforming wars, Mars sent people to Earth?
Because, like I said, they're fairly neutral, but they do have cyborg mercenaries. So Jupiter hired a group of them called the Grunthal and sent them on a mission to destroy Earth's supercomputer.
But still, why Earth? Because Earth sided with Venus. Sorry.
Yeah, exactly. And the supercomputer is called Melchizedek, which, again, is from the Bible. He was a high priest of some description. And Melchizedek, the supercomputer, was running much of the operations on Zalem and in the outer colonies. Yes.
Now, Peter, you promised us this wasn't an episode about Christianity, and now you've brought up Methuselah and Melchizedek. So it's starting to feel like
tangentially related.
Like this is another Christianity episode of the Lore Boys.
Yeah. For anyone who is still thinking about getting an elephant skull, you can get a replica one for like $2,500 and with a stand. So you don't have to actually hurt
it.
For a replica?
For a replica, yeah.
Seems way too expensive for a replica.
It must be a good replica.
I guess it's a sizable chunk.
You tell me that Jeff Beelzebub can't get me a real elephant skull on fucking Amazon?
No. Yeah, right.
You have to go. Maybe you go. I'm on skullsunlimited.com, so.
Oh, good. Oh, so, you're looking at artisanal skulls. That's why they're so expensive.
Oh, yes. That makes sense, right. Yeah. So the mercenaries managed to get into where Melchizedek is based and run a program called Guinevere. As a result, it sent Earth's colony ships hurtling towards Venus like a bunch of missiles filled with people.
Okay.
Right. Oops.
You know what they say about space rockets? They're a lot like regular rockets.
Yeah. The payload is squishier, though.
Yeah. Once you get them going, they're hard to stop them, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what they say? In space, there's nothing to slow you down.
Yeah. Except yourself.
I mean, Venus definitely did their best here, because Venus, to protect itself, used something called asteroid missiles, which I guess are just rocket pods installed on asteroids, and launched them at the colony ships, destroying the majority of them and killing hundreds of thousands of people.
I really like the idea that they used catapults. Straight up catapult. Or maybe a trebuchet, I don't know.
On the Venusian surface?
No, well, wait.
Careful, let's not get into the difference between catapults and trebuchets. There are two factions on Reddit who are very passionate about each.
So we could start a war here.
Different machines.
If it's a tension catapult, it is more effective in space. A trebuchet, like the guillotine, will not work in space.
No, because it has the counterweight that needs to launch.
I think most catapults do too, but in my head, I also am picturing some sort of weird tension catapult, which I guess more like a ballista.
I always imagined a catapult as the tension thing where you like crank it down and it's got the big like mousetrap hook at the bottom.
Yeah, but what do you get to bend like that and then unbend and snap forward?
I don't know, fresh spruce maybe? Like some kind of wood?
Yeah,
a bow and arrow.
How many times before it bends out of shape?
Or like a bow and arrow, right? Like they fill it with resin to make it more resilient.
That's what a ballista is a bow and arrow. Yeah.
I mean, they've got all the baby meat they can grease up their wheels with, so it's probably the freshest.
Unlimited energy. They also have gray goo, so.
Yeah, exactly. So who knows? But anyway, they launched using catapults from the surface of Venus, Loreboy's cannon.
Sci-fi catapults.
They launched asteroids at the colony ships and destroyed them. This would become to be known as the Camlin tragedy. The war ended shortly thereafter, and obviously Jupiter had to disavow, oh no, my mercenaries, oops-a-daisy, I just pay the bills around here, I don't know anything about what they're about to do.
Yeah, no.
So all three solar powers, Earth, Venus, and Jupiter, banded together to destroy Grunthal on Mars. Because they were just like, you guys are pretty not neutral right now, for the record.
Okay, it really feels like the mercenaries are getting the short end of the stick here. Jupiter piling in, my god.
Yeah. So destroying the Grunthal eliminated a lot of the cyborg technology that they were made out of. They were very advanced. And also wiped out all knowledge of the cyborg martial art called Panzerkunst. Which is specifically to combat cyborgs, most of which larger in zero gravity. And it is also not to be confused with the actual thing from the manga and the much stupider sounding space karate, which I did not look up because I just wanted us to make up our own explanations in our heads for what the fuck space karate is.
Wow.
Space karate.
Karate chop. Karate chop still works?
Karate chop still works in space.
Do belts work in space?
Oh.
Yeah, well, they don't need to hold your pants up, so I guess they're just useless. They technically function, but you wouldn't need one.
They hold your pants down as well as they hold your pants up in space, right? Dude.
Yeah.
Or your gi, I suppose.
Yeah.
I got my belt. It's wrapped around my pants, and then there's those little loops down there. Yeah. I don't know what the hell's going on. Yeah.
My belt's holding up my pants, and my pants are holding up my belt.
I think that's a Mitch Hedberg joke. I stole it. Yeah.
Oh, I see. Yeah. Okay.
Rip to a legend.
Yeah.
As long as we acknowledge what we stole, it's totally fine.
Yeah, that's not stealing.
So,
that's what scholarly papers are, right?
If you cite your sources, it's not stealing.
I have downloaded so much pirated Trek porn, but now I'm legally not responsible for it. So.
Perfect.
No. Yeah. Don't have to drain that swamp.
Donkey.
So, one of the mercenaries, now they weren't completely destroyed, one of the mercenaries named Yoko was captured and tried for war crimes, obviously, because her implanting the hacking into the computer did technically get all those Earth colonies destroyed.
She also broke up the Beatles, so.
Yeah. I don't know. I wonder what they were being, which one of the crimes she was actually convicted for.
Whether it was mass death at the hands of shooting spaceships into Venus or breaking up the Beatles?
Yeah, they seem equally bad. I think.
Yeah, well, no, for sure. I mean, I think one of them is much worse, but whatever. I guess Beatles, this. Right? Yeah, I guess sending rockets into Venus is kind of bad too.
Yeah, I don't know. Jamie,
What happened to Ringo?
Her only defense was ubla di ubla da, life goes on, bro. So.
Yeah. Actually, I'm actually all for them breaking up, because if they hadn't broken up, then we might not have the wonderful Beatles art that we do today from MS Paint. I think it's Ringo who makes it. Maybe it's
Ringo. Oh, yeah, that sounds right, yeah.
Yeah. Have you actually seen that, Seb?
Yeah. Honestly, so. I'd forgotten about it until you just mentioned it, but yeah, that sounds familiar.
It's like this atrocious MS Paint art that he sells for like $10,000 per copy kind of thing. Like, it's insanely priced.
I'm sure he's just fucking with people. Like, I'm sure he just knows that it's bad and he's just like, yeah, no, I'm Ringo Starr, so you're going to pay $10,000 for it, you idiot.
Yeah. So she was convicted of breaking up the Beatles and okay. was sentenced to death by orbital drop and atmospheric immolation. So that's how you execute a cyborg, is you have to destroy their entire body. Right? Okay. But remember, to be a cyborg, you need some human part, which is generally the brain. Even the Jovian box monsters have a human brain inside of them, right? Luckily for her, though, because again, the Martian cyborgs were so advanced, her brain was filled with a polymer resin instead of bitch-ass water, so it had a higher boiling point. So her brain did not boil away. So on a sunny day somewhere in Missouri, what remained of her body crashed into a scrapyard, later to be discovered by Dr. Ito, who then named her Alita,
because
she had amnesia.
I guess almost boiling the brain would be enough to give you amnesia, right?
Exactly. And just a quick side note here, she has a lot of nicknames, the creepiest of which is Octopus Lips, because her sexy, damp, pouty lips survived re-entry, apparently.
Thank God, though. Am I right?
Yes. So that's Battle Angel Alita, or the lead up to it. She has a biography, so I might get into that one day. This is ridiculous and fun. But this is all the setup you will need to start with Battle Angel Alita, because it starts with Dr. Ito discovering her body in the scrapyard. And this is how she got there.
Cool.
Very cool. And a little silly. And I'm sorry I got so bogged down on the ethics of... Jamie mentioned it on the show. I'm a vegetarian. And I'm a moral vegetarian, and I would totally eat lab-grown meat. But for some reason, making the lab-grown meat specifically human meat really fucks me up for no good reason. You know what I mean? Like, why do you got to do that?
That was a decent aside, I think. That's why we do this show, is to get the gears in people's head really turning about the fiction that they decide to consume.
Yeah, I'm a juvetarian. I only eat young things.
Oh.
If something grows up, then I won't do it.
A pedotarian?
Oh, God. I don't like it when you say it like that.
I like it much better my way, thank you.
Anyway, yeah, so most importantly for this one, thank you, Saucy, for the suggestion. If you guys want to suggest, just to reiterate, suggest anything, jump into our Discord. We have a lore suggestions channel open to all of you lunatics. There is no barrier to entry for that. You don't need to pay nothing. Just send us your dumb fucking ideas.
Yeah.
That's it.
If you want to get in touch with me, you can find me at Ethan the Deadman on Twitter. We're at Loreboys on Twitter also. Loreboys.com, that's the website. You can find links to most of our stuff from there. If anything's missing, just feel free to shout it out at us. But like Peter said, Discord's a good way to get in touch with us. Contact at loreboys.com is a good way to get in touch with us. We also have an email from the person who recommended we cover this topic. I think that they had mentioned it to us on Discord before they sent us this email also recommending we do it. But Peter insisted that I should read it only on the podcast and not before. So here we go, a blind read of the email.
Only because this email arrived when this episode was already planned as the next one, meaning it was just a fun little coinky-dink.
From Haru Kaimurama. To the magnificent males of Mythos, this is a bit of a short one compared to most, but think of it as an elaborate, or dare I say, unneeded excuse for an email. But it has come to my attention that you three were for a glimpse of a lifetime stumped on one of the essential philosophy of our very existence. Who wins in a hentai? As gaining an overpriced degree in hentology, most experts in this area would say the viewer is the true winner of such an endeavor. Unless such a video or doujin is labeled under the infamous category of ugly bastard, then the answer would be no one would win. Anyways, I look forward to the Alita lore video at some point. Sincerely, your idiosyncratic debutante, Saucy. Thanks so much.
Good email.
There you go.
And of course, if you guys want to get in touch with us, we've already said it, but contact at loreboys.com is the best way to do so. Leaving us a review on iTunes or your favorite podcasting app is maybe not the best way to get in touch with us, but it's something that we'll love you forever for. And if you recommend us cover something on iTunes, it's the most surefire way to make sure we actually will cover it. Whereas if you recommend it to us in Discord, we'll decide if we like it first. Jamie, where can they find you?
Lately, we've been trying to be a little bit more active on the social media stuff. So, I'm taking care of Facebook, Peter's got Instagram, and Ethan's got Twitter. And if you could follow us on all three of those things, you can find it in loreboys.com/about. That's be a really cool way to just help us get to the next level, because we want to be more active on social media. Those likes, comments, shares, even just starting a conversation on any of those things really helps us a lot. So please try and follow us there. And if you're probably on the bus to work right now, you could just pull up Facebook or Twitter right now. Maybe you're in the shower. You could just get out and run to your computer real quick. Whatever you're doing when you're listening, you could find time.
Yeah, that's what I want.
Doctor, put down that scalpel, okay?
Yeah.
Hop onto the PC, okay? I know you're listening to us in surgery, okay? Just put it on pause. He's under. He's not going anywhere. Just log on iTunes. Leave us a review.
Toss those AirPods right into the guts and just get in there. Yeah.
Jesus. And for me, you can find me at Pete O'Donohue on Twitter, at Loreboys Podcast on Instagram. And for this is it's currently early August 2020, where I am streaming as often as I can. I am building Warhammer minis. I have started a Battle Sister squad. I will be doing a pair of Penitent engines, and Ethan has some Orc boys that I'm going to be building as well. I have some contract work coming up in September, so if you're past that, I'm probably not streaming anymore, but I will do it as often as I can, pretty much any time of the day, because I like building toys in front of people. And that's going to be twitch.tv/theloreboys.
Yeah,
I've been meaning to set up OBS and just stream one of these WoW raids while we're still doing progression. But that'll happen eventually. Yeah.
Eventually. It'll happen once you're no longer doing progression, I'm sure. I guess we all owe a big shout out to Terry. We have patreon.com/theloreboys/loreboys. I don't know why I can't remember this ever.
Find it. We do have new patrons.
People do find it. It's one of the two. Patreon.com/theloreboys, I can confirm right now. And big shout out to our new top tier patron, Terry, like we said. Two of the three spots still remaining. If anybody wants to get in on a couple sessions of Dungeons & Dragons with us, ya boys, it's one of the tiers. Peter will send you some personalized custom artwork, and you will have to split mineral rights with Terry. I'm not sure how legally we're going to do that, because we've already promised him full mineral rights to Jamie's body. But
Well, trust me, guys. Terry's been drilling, and he's been drilling. He hasn't found anything yet, but he's relentless.
Yeah.
Yikes.
I mean, he's a Minecraft pro, so he knows how to get it. You know, he knows where to find it. If you want to support us, go to patreon.com/theloreboys, and you can support us there. If you don't want to go to Patreon because you don't trust them, because maybe they're giant, fat, floating heads who secretly eat people, you can always go to Twitch, or you can go to Loreboys Prime, which is where we run our own Patreon, if you will. I think we started doing it first, so I think Patreon honestly owes us some royalties on all the transactions they make, but we're in a long-standing legal battle with them, so we'll figure that out in our own time. In the meantime, if you want to support us, just send us some money in the mail. I don't care how much money it is. I don't care if it's even really money. It could be toenail clippings. It can be bottle caps. It could be an old lamp. Send us anything that you have. You work in a textile factory, send us bolts of cloth. You got old batteries that aren't charged, just send us those old batteries that aren't charged. We'll charge them up and we'll use them ourselves. And in return, we'll give you, so we've been in a, Jamie's been in a bit of a Facebook flame war with Rorgan Gamzee about the definition of raw meat. So he's been working on some sushi. And Jamie's going to jam a bunch of his homemade sushi into an envelope and ship it off to you wherever you are in the world. So just reach out to us and we'll get that to you. Rorgan Gamzee, I think he said he's using lab-grown meat of some description. I don't know. I haven't seen a picture of him in a while, but I'm starting to suspect he might have a very large head and be very corpulent.
Well, we do know he's got excellent legs.
Gamzee. Oh, he's very Gamzee. Yeah. And I guess that would constitute a Lore Boys Battle
Lore
Angel.
Oh.
My name's Ethan, and we're goofing around and doing a podcast, a soundtrack podcast, pod soundtrack.
Yeah, my name.
You guys are all over each other today.
Fuck. Yeah.
Oh, good. This is a good soundtrack.
Yeah, I'm not looking at the cameras right now, so I can't see Jamie like start to open his mouth. So I just take that after the 1 second gap when you're done. I just take. That is my opportunity to go because you're like the tiny one up in the right hand corner.
No, see, you can't just hold your mouth open, Jimmy. You got to look like you're about to open your mouth, like.
Yeah. One of the principles of animation is squash and stretch. So you need to squash your face before you stretch for talk.
Oh, that's actually interesting. I didn't know about that.
Yeah, it's like that booty, squash and stretch.
Yeah,
you stretch it to fit a squash in there.
Damn.